Let's circle back to item A1. Reading the title, Memorandum of Understanding, parentheses, Letter of Support for the Renewal of the Grant Application with the Administrative Office of the Courts, parentheses, AOC, for Community Therapeutic Court. And I'll recap again that this came to me last week. There was a grant deadline Friday, and the judge is here to request, as in the packet, an action from us. And so again, this will be an action item and the action item of this evening. So let me welcome Judge Tracy Flood here to present on this item.
This is the last one, so why don't I share
with Quinn? Yeah, I have another one.
Handouts here. Okay. Let me ask, Judge, is this for this item specifically on A1, or is this for some of the following items?
This is for A1. This is Councilmember okay. Now made the request. So I said that the next time I see you, I will bring it. Unfortunately, it couldn't be. I'm mastering the uploading and documents and providing it to you in advance of something that could be emailed. In addition, and the second stack of the is for the direct item that is on the agenda, which is the renewal application that was sent to the state. So first I'll preface this by saying my apologies, as I sent to you the MOU that we previously did from last year, which was approved in the initial grant making process. If you recall, we did, maybe about four different grant applications. One of those required matching funds for SOFI. So the MOU was specific for AOC and the matching funds, one that we applied for the big federal grant. So that was the attachment that I gave you along with the agenda bill. We were not required to submit a letter of support. This year is a little bit different. We're going into the 2023-2024 state budget. I was a part of the District and Municipal Court Judges Association legislative team that went down to Olympia, and I think I've mentioned this before. We went down and talked with our representatives and our senators and asked for the governor to and the senators to support adding funding that continued to support the existing community court programs and to be able to add community court programs. Ours falls under the category of an existing community court. With that, we were successful, and it is a part of the governor's budget, where there's, don't quote me on this, but I believe about $10 million set aside for existing community courts and to add community courts. So because it's a part of the governor's budget, technically it is not a grant. It's a continuing source fund. So we will go from the current funds that have been allocated to us under the grant that we did apply for last year, that ends on June 30th, 2023, to the current funding, July 1st of 2023. So there's no gap. So when you receive my email, because we are trying to avoid there being a gap in funding, the period in time for everything was very short. I've shown you letters from our community partners that are part of the community courts, and that's a part of the packet. So basically, they should just wanted to know, community supports the community court. And we're not going to run into the issue of having to come back to city council for any approvals or acceptance of funds, which is different than what happened last year. Last year, you saw me last summer a lot because I had to come in, get the application approved, had to come in and get acceptance of the funds. And all of those funds for that grant was provided in two increments, two installments that was paid up front. Going forward, it will be more like a invoicing, A19 submitting on a monthly basis. So that's why it's considered funding versus a grant. because if the funds aren't, of course, you don't have them used or billed out by the end of the year, there's nothing that's been advanced to you, and you don't have to go back to City Council and say, City Council, we need to now send some funds back to the state. And because it's a part of the governor's budget, it's not considered quote unquote a grant, but it's a continuation of funding going forward. Because of the short turnaround, the document it just didn't change. So again, I apologize for that. And the MOU was just a sample to have as to knowing that this is something that the City Council approved and supported, but a simple letter that says, as the City Council for the Bremerton City, we continue to support the community. Just all that there, as you see in those other letters that have been sent to the state. And they did, because they hadn't received the copy of the MOU that was provided, the one that all the parties signed from our packet. So that was that demonstration. And so that's why at the top of the agenda bill, it says approval of letter. And then at the bottom, because I didn't have the upgrade. So that is pretty much all the request is at this time, is that City Council continues to support the community court program.
Does any member of the public wish to comment on this item? If you're online, you can raise your hand using the Zoom raise hand function, or I'm not sure if any members of the public in the audience, you can just raise your physical hand.
Or we're taking action on this.
Yes, action is. Let me check online.
If anybody wants comments,
hey, I'm not seeing any hands online and nothing in the room, so I'll go ahead and close public comment. I'll go to the council for a motion. It sounds like the recommended motion in the packet is now not the one being requested. Do you have a new recommended motion, Judge Flood?
So the motion would be just to the City Council to just have a letter of support that just simply states the continued support of the community court program.
Okay.
City Council.
All right.
I apologize.
Does any member of council wish to make a motion?
Do we have recommended wording for that?
It sounds to me like a possible recommended motion, Judge. Well, I'm going to let you find the exact words that you request, but move to approve the City Council submitting a letter of support in support of this program. Sorry, in support of this grant application.
I'm happy to
continuation.
Give, continuation.
Well, it's a grant application, right?
Well,
it's an application.
It's an application.
Yeah, it's a renewal.
So yeah, so it'd be a letter of support in the application.
Yeah, it's a renewal application. Yeah. So proposed language would be the City Council of Bremerton Municipal Court. The Bremerton City Council continues to support the community court program and supports the renewal application. Just that.
So moved. I don't know about their wording.
Did we capture? Yeah,
it's on the.
Yes, council member.
It's not there. It's a different wording now.
That's
But it's in it's in record.
I'm saying it just got recorded.
Okay. So let me rescind that then. I make a motion that Bremerton City Council write a letter of support for continued grant funding for the therapeutic court for the Bremerton Municipal Therapeutic Court.
Let's read that back, so I don't want there to be any misunderstanding. Lori, I know you're online. Do you mind? I don't know if you're capturing this motion, but I want it to be real clear.
Okay. So what I had was, I was still typing, move to approve the City Council submit a letter in support or in continued support of the grant funding application for the what is it, Bremerton Community Therapeutic Court.
That sounds roundabout what I said. Is that, how do those words sound to everybody else?
Okay, I think that captures the request correctly. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so if you want to say so moved on that one.
So moved.
All right, is there a second? All right, we have a second by Councilmember Dennehy. You have the floor, Councilmember Chamberlain.
Okay. Okay, so this is just a letter of support. It looks like this MOU is something that just needs to be signed between you and the mayor. And so what you need from us is just a letter saying that we think that this program is worthwhile to Bremerton.
So we already have an MOU that you say that. That's from last year.
Okay.
The letter that you just approved is for the renewal application.
We haven't technically approved it yet. We're voting on it. This is just this is the discussion period. Right. Yeah.
So it's for the renewal application.
Right.
So a letter that comes from city council is sufficient. They just need something from the city of Bremerton because we're a city court.
Okay.
It doesn't have to be the mayor's signature. It can be the mayor's signature on behalf of city council, or it can be the city council president on behalf of the city. So it's just vice versa.
Yes. Okay. And so what data do we have to show that the Bremerton Community Therapeutic Court is an effective program in Bremerton?
So as far as when you say what data do we have,
yes,
we're a brand new program. It mm-hmm. started in January. When you say, is it a successful program? We just had our mid-year review with the county, and they are very satisfied with where we are because we're a brand new court. I met with Judge Rufus, the brand new court program, who ran the drug court and superior court for a number of years.
Yeah.
And when he started his program, they didn't have any applicants. When we started it on January 1, we did have one initial applicant that started the program with us. What we have learned over the last 6 months is that it'll be very important for us to look at our processes. And one of those things has already come before the city council and how the job description was written for the coordinator. And the way that the job description was written for the coordinator was done by staff at the time that specifically included more clerical functions than therapeutic court functions.
Gotcha.
So the support specialist position, now we have two of those, matches up with wraparound services, matches up with individuals who have the knowledge, skills, and training to be able to address both substance abuse and mental health issues that we're seeing in this program. So being that we are just at our sixth month, it is, I am happy to see where we are because again, in speaking with and traveling to other courts around, even looking at our local district court, they indicate there's times when there's good seasons, there's times where, you know, you see it fluctuate up and down. Another similar court, single judge court bench, that has a community court program is Jefferson County with Judge Walker, Mindy Walker there. She also indicated it took some time. Our goal for the year with the county was to hopefully be at 15 by the end of the year, but it's an ongoing rotation process in which we look at the fact that while it's anticipated, it would be a year, but most programs average 18 months. We know that from statistics through the Washington State Institute for Public Policy that it's known that the first time out of treatment, there's a 17% success rate and 83% rate of that they're not going to succeed on their first time.
And my understanding is, I mean, with the new blank fix, that it's going to be probably really important for us to have a therapeutic court in order to stay in compliance with the new, you know, mandates. I don't have a problem supporting it. I guess my concern would just be I don't have much data to go off of to say why we support it, other than we need this resource, right?
I can say when you talk about data, it's the portal. We do. We just did our first quarter portal report to the county, and going forward, that's those numbers that I'm reporting to the county, I'll also include in my reports to the state, because one of the things that they want us to begin to do is track the data. So we have been tracking through a spreadsheet, Excel, as to the number.
Yeah.
Of contacts that were made by giving out the application and those that expressed interest. And again, I spoke with Ms. Hannah yesterday and made a connection by email today with the district court, therapeutic court manager there to be able to partner and look at how they make sure that everyone is being told. And the blank fix actually addresses that, that everyone who's coming through be told what programs and what options, what resolutions are available to them when it comes to this. So it's very timely and will continue to be needed.
Is there any way that we can, I mean, like just for our sake, before the next, we're voting on it today. All right, that's all the questions I have. Thank you.
So I promise you that I believe by the time I come back, there'll be two quarters of data that we'll be able to provide.
Thank you.
Councilmember Denny.
Thank you, Judge Flood, for presenting. So the MOU that we're looking at right now, I don't remember if this was the number that you quoted. Is this correct that you'd be asking for $380,000?
So the application renewal is what that figure is.
So the MOU in front of me is the MOU that we would be supporting?
No, I don't need you to support an MOU because we have an MOU, but it was just as suggested language.
Got you.
So the only thing action that I need to be taken today is a letter.
I understand the letter. I'm asking how much funding are you asking for? Not from us, but from the state.
$380,000.
Gotcha. Okay. So it is this number. Mm-hmm. And do you have the staff to administer this?
Yeah.
Okay, great. I think City Council wants to do everything in its purview to make sure that the municipal court is successful. Mm-hmm. Okay. So I support this.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. So what I will say is the funding allows for there to be these support.
Sorry, Judge Flood. No question was asked to you. I'm going to move on to another council member if anyone else wants to speak. Yes, Council Member Fry.
I think we all want this program to be successful. I really do. And I want clarification on any effect the Blake fix, if having this is actually a requirement in that statute. I think I have sat on a lot of grant review boards on a local, state, and national level for federal, state, and local funds. And I, in light of the allegations that have been made about the use of those funds attached to this grant, I have major concerns. I don't believe this went through the process, certainly, that the city preaches. I know we don't always have to go through process, and I understand that and I embrace it. However, having said that, it seems like this is the mode of presentation to us, is it's chaotic and it's last minute and it's not all the information. And sometimes I'm not sure of the information, quite frankly, that I'm being given. And that puts me personally in a really awkward position with my integrity. And I want this to succeed. I would just as soon as put a pause on it because I think we got a lot of things to work on here. And I'm not one, I really take those, the intent of a piece of legislation and the funding that accompanies it is sacred. I mean, it's critically important in the relationship between citizens and their government institutions. And I'm not feeling it. And I'm worried that council for stamp after stamp after stamp with this. And
I'm not sensing that it's getting any better. If anything, I think it's getting worse. And I have to speak out for my own integrity. Judge Plug and I go back, and I have to do what's right in my own sense of integrity as a city council member and as chair of the public safety committee. This did not come through public safety. I had no idea how my two colleagues might feel about this. Those processes are there for a reason, and it implies an obligation to oversee. It implies oversight, and I'm not feeling good about moving forward with this, and I may be the only one, but I've got to speak my truth, and that's my truth. So that's it. No questions.
Any other council member? Got a few questions if not, and we can do a second round if needed. Thanks so much, Judge Flood, for bringing this before us. In the packet, we have this old MOU, a blank new MOU. You provided us a couple letters of support from other organizations. Do you have a copy of the application that you're submitting, that you're asking us to support?
So, no, it was all submitted electronically on Friday, as the deadline is 5 p.m. on Friday.
Okay, so we don't have a copy of the application to view. And can you clarify how much you're asking for again? You said 380,000, but in the MOU it says 308,000. So
he said 300 is the number in the MOU, correct? I said yes, the number in the MOU is correct.
Okay, so it's 308,000.
The MOU says 380.
It's 380.
At least in the recitals subparagraph
so
B.
Which MOU are you looking at? Are you looking at the MOU that was previously?
I'm sorry, in the packet. It does say 380. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, sorry, let's
keep. But there should be two MOUs.
Yeah, Councilmember Quinn, I got it now. Thank you.
The first one.
Okay, Councilmember Quinn, sorry.
Oh, sorry.
It's okay. Okay, so it does say 380. Thank you. Sorry about that. That was my dyslexia there.
The first one is the one that was submitted for our original application pack. And then the second one.
Okay, so gotcha. So you're asking for 380,000. Okay. How much did you get in funds last year for the same grant?
It wasn't the same grant. It's a different process this year. So last year, when you say how much did I get?
I'm sorry.
Judge Flood has not received anything.
Sorry, Judge. How much did the court receive? How much was this grant for last year?
It was a different grant last year. That's what I'm explaining to you. So last year, the grant process was where money was given up front. The city has received that money in two installments, 107,000. I don't have the exact figure. Finances present, we can give you that exact figure. So the city received two installments from the state for the therapeutic court program.
Finance Director Riley, do you know the number of the amount of funds from last year? Sure.
For the therapy program, it's 200,000.
Okay. So we're going from 215,896 to 380,000. What's the justification for the increase in grants?
Because last year, the three grants that were applied for were all through the state. The 215,000 that he's referring to was one part of that grant. There was also additional funds through smaller grants that cover case management, supporting our participants in programs, peer counseling, making sure they have transportation back and forth. So when you total the total amount of all three grants, it came to a little bit over 300,000.
So for this specific therapeutic court grant from the—
I need to finish answering the question. Let me finish. What they asked for us to do was to include a percentage of increase for salaries, benefits, because the grant program supports two positions. So the funding includes two employees, one full-time employee and one part-time employee, along with the participants in the program. So that's what the funding supports. And all of that funding, again, is managed by the city.
Thank you. So this 216,000 from the previous cycle from the administrative office of the courts. What was that? What has that money been spent on so far?
I don't have that, because when you're asking me what has it been spent on,
okay,
the finance director can tell you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Finance Director Riley, can you talk to that?
We had a third grade coordinator and additional time spent from staff to the court administrator and the judge. And also we had some computer monitors at the Bureau of Grades to put forward in total for the year 51,414.
Okay. So for last year, although the grant was for 216, you spent that 51,000 and change. No. Yes.
Primarily on
salaries, the therapeutic court coordinator. Okay. Now, in the recent Kitsap Sun article, it's been alleged that the therapeutic court coordinator was not working most of the time on the therapeutic court. And Finance Director Riley, is it true that if that is the case and the therapeutic court coordinator was not working on something related to the grant, that we can't get reimbursed for that money potentially?
Within the agreement, it talks about the cost of therapeutic court is pretty broad within the therapeutic court, but what's alleged in the article working on dental court services would not be able to do it.
Okay, so if those services are not eligible, the city potentially would have to compensate for that salary from the general fund?
Yeah.
Okay, $51,000. And with this new grant request, if approved for $380,000, if that is true and that happens again, then the city would also potentially be on the hook for compensating from general funds?
Correct.
Okay. That gives me some concern. So the therapeutic court's been running about 6 months. How many individuals have gone through it, Judge Flood?
Not gone through it. It's
okay.
Participant.
How many have participated in it?
We're, I believe, at four. I don't have the stats in front of me, but.
Attorney Fennell, do you know how many participants, by chance?
I can answer
that. Oh, sure. Prosecutor.
We had the initial applicant. She's technically still involved. She's in custody pending competency proceedings. We have one individual who's currently in the program, another who entered and didn't come back after like a couple weeks and is on warrant status. And then we had another applicant who had to withdraw the application, and another recent applicant who was arrested for new crimes. So right now I'd say we have five total applicants, but only two who are technically in the program.
Okay, thank you. And then Judge Flood, before the meeting, I just searched online for the name of this grant and see if there's any information. I did find this website from Washington Courts that has information about the grant. It looks like it opened at least May 5th. There was a Zoom session. There was an FAQ. I have significant concerns about this coming to us, I mean, past the deadline for the application to be submitted. And in here is a PDF that lists the application requirements. Right at the top, it has to be considered complete, all application areas must be filled in, including the budget field, and be signed by the county city sign-in letter with supporting documents to include a supporting letter from your city council, a supporting letter from your prosecutor, a supporting letter from your defender's office, if applicable. So it seems like it was pretty clear what they were asking for over a month and a half ago. Do you have a supporting letter from the prosecutor for this grant?
The packet was taken in and put forth by my former court administrator and should have been emailed out to all parties. I learned yesterday or recently from Mr. Percy that he got the information from Ms. Fennell. The emails were sent, I believe, by Jennifer to Ms. Fennell versus the parties. As the judge, I do not have. There's a certain wall that should exist when doing certain parameters and presenting things, and that poses a bit of a challenge as far as oversight and understanding the things that are being submitted, the things that are coming in, as Mr. Hersey was able to provide you with actual applicants. I don't actually have that information that comes to me, because if we don't want the process to be tainted. Whereas if I know they've applied to the court and there may be a reason why they're rejected, not knowing and being able to speak directly to those issues is not specifically for me, which if you look at the original MOU that was done last year, that's why it says, this is the prosecutor's role, this is the defense role, this is the court's role.
Can I stop and ask, do you have a copy of the prosecutor's letter of support in hand?
I haven't received any letters of support other than what I provided to you.
Okay.
And I'm still in the process of obtaining that.
Okay, with the grant. The grant having been due Friday. Okay, so we have a letter from West Sound Treatment Center. We have a letter from Sound Integrated Health, and we have a letter from Armstrong Law, and a letter from Grow Together.
That's what I've received so far. There's okay. A letter coming from Kitsap Mental Health and all of the other community court partners, which have been a part of it, that have said that they would get letters.
Council, I have some really serious concerns. I'm going to echo Council Member Fry. Then we can go to the round of questions, comments. I'm seeing a large jump in grant funding. The previous one was spent on a person who has made allegations that they weren't actually working on the grant. The city may be on the hook for the general fund to cover that amount of money. If that happens again, I'm worried it's coming out of the general fund as well. We don't have a copy of the application to review that we're being asked to support, which would be typical. It sounds like other parts of the application are missing. We've learned there has been significant turnover at the court, and I have significant concerns about how this grant would be administered. And I worry about the city's liability if this grant is not administered properly, not only for legal reasons, but for the amount of money the city would be on the hook for. So I also cannot support this grant at this time. I think it's also something that should be tabled until a future date. So Councilmember Mockler, I saw you had your hand up if you want to take a round.
I don't think we should support this grant and that we should consider it at some future time. And I think that for the same reason that when Fire Chief Magani and Police Chief Wolf came to us and delivered an entirely oral presentation from notes, I was vehement that we had to have all the written material in front of us to study before we could make any determination. At this point, we have virtually nothing that we can look at. We lack the grant application. We lack an associate of the judges who would know what is happening administratively with all the pieces of the grant application. We have verbal assurances, and as I was vehemently opposed to that when the police chief and the fire chief presented before us, I am opposed to it again. I think we are here to provide oversight, and we can't do that based on speech alone. We have to have actual documents that we've had time to review. So I can't support this either.
Sure. Okay. Let's do a second round here. Councilmember Dennehy, then Chamberlain.
Okay.
Thanks. Church Flood, that kind of goes to my first question of whether or not you'd have staff to administer this. Like, I would hate to miss out on $380,000 worth of state grant funding in a city that desperately needs a therapeutic court. And so I want to make this work. Can you tell us about, I think you just said that your past administrator was the one that had the information that was submitted. Can you tell us let me finish. Can you tell me about your plan of who would be administering this and who would make sure that the city isn't on the hook for something coming out of the general fund that we're not going to be approving, that we assume state funding would take care of?
So the grant application, the original grant application, was due last summer. It took until October and several city council meetings like this one when we kept having to come back, that then the position was created and then the position didn't get filled until mid-October. So if you say the grant fund started July, August, September, October, it took 4 months to get through city council to get a person into a job. That there had been no other job descriptions out there about it. The services support specialist, yes, there's history there, which was why we said going forward, this is a better dedicated position for the community court. Also, the tracking of my time, as well as anyone's time who was involved and participating in our community court hearings, staffings, and meetings, as well as our resource fairs, is all what is covered under that grant. So while you're saying you think that, well, we're going to be on the hook for this, there's more involved than just the therapeutic court coordinator position. There, the hours are trackable because the work was being done on a flex work schedule where he dedicated this particular times and actually said it in an email. I do this many hours on community court programs and I do this many hours on other things supporting the court.
I guess to clarify, I'm less concerned about what has happened and what assurances we have that this would be administered in a way that conforms with the grant guidelines.
Going forward, we have a dedicated person whose their job has is separate, and that's why?
That's already been hired.
Sorry, yes.
Okay. And how long have they been in the role? They just started?
So if we want to, I can't give you a date. So if okay. We look at our current services support, yes, thank you. Our flow chart there,
gotcha.
You see that it's out so that probation services and community court are separate from our clerk's office. That's the flow chart that needed, that was the separation that was needing to take place.
So you're talking about the probation services department. That's where this would be housed.
You the said. Community courts. Is
and somebody, committed. There is a position that so somebody was hired into already.
We have two dedicated positions. The services support position, there were two hires. There were two hires made.
Can you tell me the names of those hires, the service support specialist and the service support specialist / therapeutic?
So Alexis is for our therapeutic court program. And I'm drawing a blank on card. The other person was from out of state for our probate, for our just regular services support program, and was hired, but had a medical emergency. So we're in the process of refilling that. So they had been hired.
So there's a pocket for this. This person hasn't been hired. Mm-hmm. Alexis, what's this person's last name? Sorry.
Boiler.
There is the service support specialist. And then is this probation services department, is that like a court administrator? Is that a position as well? Or is that just an umbrella?
No, there's
no umbrella. Okay, so there's no position there. No. So you have two people to staff, basically. Mm-hmm. One who's been recently hired, and then one pocket that is now open. Mm-hmm. Okay. That's my concern. I think, and I'll pass it to Vice President Chamberlain in a second, but yeah. I'm sorry?
I could add to this.
Can you add to this?
To my response. Yeah.
Oh, to your response. Yes.
Yes. Yeah. So because you're saying how can there be a separation and an assurance? Because it's now a department, and when I say this probation services department, is separated out so that the tracking of and timing and what they're doing is dedicated specifically to the case management of our participants. Whereas we didn't have that before because it was the background and experience was lacking in what was required for that job position to be filled, which goes from the experience of having a position created by staff that didn't have any experience with community court program. So that therapeutic court coordinator position did not go through the HR and them finding the job descriptions. That went through the interim assistant court administrator at that time, looking at it as what the needs, entire needs of the court. And so that's how the job description ended up being somewhat conflicted with having basically two different, almost like three different hats that it had to have.
Thank you for that. And then I saw Mike's hand.
They're doing that, yes. Just clarify, there was a little bit of the conversation. I'll dig in. We have the personal record. So right now, currently, the support services probation is open for like this. The therapeutic corpus, I think.
Gotcha. So, yeah.
I confirmed that once.
Okay, perfect. That's again, I share similar concerns, but I also have a conflicting concern of leaving this money on the table. So I'll defer to Vice President Chamberlain for that.
Thank you, Councilor Quinn. Dennehy. Okay, so I would like to ask a couple other directors some questions. Director Riley, I'm just looking at last year's MOU, and it says that the city will take necessary steps to provide 200K. So over 48-month period. So have we matched that already?
So if I could speak to the MOU last year, yeah. Not tied to the therapeutic or state grant. That was for the federal application, the 600K.
Okay. So this is not related. This is just an accidental addition.
I believe that was added to use that language to change the AOC for this year as a letter of commitment originally. I think we're banning that. But yeah, that was not associated with the AOC.
Okay. But we have matched 200K, at least 100K for...
We did not receive the MOU.
Gotcha.
So there was no matching funds.
So okay. We didn't get that one.
Right.
Okay. Mr. Hersey, if we don't have a therapeutic court, then our referrals from the police or Attorney Fennell, would go to the county, correct? Okay, how would that go if we could to meet the Blake? I know y'all are still digging in, but you must have a understanding of how we're going to meet all those referrals.
My reading of the new Blake bill is that it doesn't require a therapeutic court. It does create a new diversion program, which sounds really similar, but okay. It's different. So no, there would be no issue there as far as being able to file cases or anything like that.
So what's the plan for a diversion court for within our municipality?
So we already have diversion.
Perfect.
So
yeah.
There are a lot of different ways cases can resolve.
Okay.
You can do a traditional plea and be put on what formerly called probation, or you can do a pretrial diversion agreement, which we had. And everything.
I know all about those.
Yes.
Had a couple. Yes, sir.
But so that's a really common way cases resolve. And then Judge Blood's new therapeutic court is kind of like a third option, which is a more intensive version of what we call PDA, pretrial diversion.
Okay.
But there are still, and there are also deferred prosecutions, which is statutory.
Okay.
There's
a lot of diversion options that meet the Blake requirement. Yes.
I was just going to say the Blake requirement actually has the diversion requirement in the statute. That's kind of the new thing about that.
Okay.
Before it was on each individual prosecuting agency to kind of develop their own diversion agreements. And the Blake decision standardized for this particular class of crimes statewide, which is new, but it's not, it's in the statute of like what that diversion looks like.
Okay, Director Riley, I have one more question for you.
Yeah.
If you know, are you well acquainted with the grant application that we're talking about today?
No.
Okay, all right. So I guess my larger question is, if we were not to support, actually, it sounds like, honestly, if we're past the deadline, I don't know. There's a lot of times your agencies be flexible on those deadlines. My question is, if we don't get it, we'll probably have to go through the process again to like the initial application for next year, or does the process start all over again?
So you ever apply, isn't it? We have funding for the therapeutic court program that requires for us to apply for every grant application. So okay. if this is not supported on my grant application to the 0.1% to the county that we're going through to December. I will have to say that the county, the city did not support it because they ask all grant applicants, as you're aware, ask how much have you applied for? And so that's what we're doing. We're applying for everything that we
do diligence.
We're doing our due diligence. Okay. Unfortunately, again, this happened at a time where there's things that as far as transitions with staffing, new staffing coming in, staffing going out, but the challenge going forward is if you are saying that as a city council, you do not support the Bremerton Municipal Community Court Program, when we're in the only full-time municipal court program, I am the first elected African-American woman judge in this county, that you don't want to support this court regardless of allegations. They are just that, allegations. So I'll speak directly to that. If that's what you're saying, that our community doesn't deserve this program, that you don't want to, and this is different than the application last year where we were given a bucket of money up front. This is the A19s will go in just like the 0.1%. And you should see that their president, that it says this is funding that is different from the grant. So we're continuing to say grant, but it's different funding because it's part of the governor's budget versus money that we received last year. So when you're looking at what you're looking at, I tried to provide you as much information where we, well, the MOU specifically said matching funds. It does mention the state grant and supporting that process because we had to put that in there and the federal grant. So it does reference that this city council, that the city supported establishing this court program. Statistics show that deferred prosecutions have not put a dent in recidivism. While we have that available, the pretrial diversion agreements, we have more revocation hearings on pretrial diversion agreements than we have new charges that are being filed. So the city prosecutor chooses to provide this stipulated order of continuance, but what numbers do we have if that is successful? Just like we're saying, how do you know that this is successful? You can't come in and say, on one hand, yes, you're 6 months in and I'm not hopeful. I see all of these things happening. It's also a public lynching. It's a public lynching of the first Black woman judge.
Sorry, Judge.
You know what? I have another question.
I'm going to ask everyone in the room to refrain from personal comments and attacks of that nature. Yes, Councilmember Chamberlain, you have another question.
So, I really appreciate your response. Thank you for that information. I think that what I'd like to say is that I've been super supportive of you all along the way and super supportive of having, Black women in this position. I would love for my job to be taken one day, in the same way. What we all have a problem with is that we don't trust what you're bringing to us. And that's it. It has nothing to do with anything that you've allegated today. And that is all I'll say. Thank you.
And I understand.
Does any other council member want to speak on this? Yeah, we'll finish up a second round and then we'll go to a vote.
Yeah, I do want to make it clear that I really support the premise of this court, this program. They're closing around us. Seattle just closed their community court program. I really do think the court, would benefit by pushing the pause button and let's take stock. Let's figure out better how to move forward in this direction. Because when you say that we are trying to say the community doesn't deserve a therapeutic court, what we're trying to say is the community deserves better than this. And I mean that sincerely. And that's all I'll say.
Your council member, good now.
I feel that, first of all, I feel like this whole council supports this therapeutic board. And I feel like we're taking it very seriously. And I feel like the court brought this to us literally at the 11th hour. And then that's all I have.
Thank you. Councilmember Mockler.
Thank you. You know that I have supported you as well, and I really support this therapeutic court. I can't make a judgment on a course of action that there's no documentation for. I just can't do it. I've got to have something, like actual evidence in front of me. I am in favor of tabling this for the future because this is such a great idea, such a great vision for a therapeutic court. And it's exactly what could help the people here in Bremerton. And we need bodies to administer it. We need an understanding of what the grant application and all the associated documents would entail. So I hope they are provided at some future point. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Denny.
I have a final question for City Attorney Fennell, if you're able to answer. Council President alluded to the possibility of the city being on the hook if the grant isn't administered appropriately. Can you speak to any sort of liability that exposure that you see?
I'll defer to Finance Director Riley on that question, and I'll repeat it for his clarification. Councilmember Dennehy asked about the comments made by Council President about the city being responsible for grant funds that were expended in violation of grant and what the risk of that.
So typically in grant funding, if they find that your costs, your costs are not eligible, it becomes question costs, and then we'll recover those funds from the enterprise. So in this case, if they're being developed, we'll be able to set back the funds.
Money that we would receive. So it wouldn't be affecting our it would be affecting our general budget because then that would be general costs. Okay. I hear what everybody is saying, and my take, somebody that deals with allegations every day, and I don't make any decisions on any of my cases until I've heard all sides of the story and all evidence is presented, I am going to vote, and I think we should vote in favor of supporting it, and really wishing you the best to administer it as judiciously as possible. And aside from the media article, I really do hope that you are successful. So I'm gonna end my comments there.
Okay, thank you. I'll wrap up with I want to be on the record too that I support therapeutic court. I'm so sorry, the judge. I'm just gonna wrap up and we're gonna vote.
I'm happy to provide more evidence next week. And
yeah.
The state actually.
Okay, I'm gonna finish here. I want to be on the record. I support therapeutic court. I echo Councilmember Fry's comments that I think the citizens of Bremerton deserve a well-functioning therapeutic court and a well-functioning court in general. But we are echoing Councilmember Mockler's comments. We don't have the grant before us that we're being asked to support. There is not a person currently in the therapeutic court coordinator position to administer it. The article, regardless of allegations, the facts is that there has been unprecedented turnover in court staff. And that gives me pause on running this program. I'm hearing that a few individuals have participated, but I'm also hearing that there are other programs for these folks for diversion that are available that a therapeutic court is really nice to have, but it's not essential to the functioning of the court. And so given all that, and especially that we're council, you know, we're stewards of the taxpayers' dollars. And every single item that's come before us, I believe for the past year and a half, with the exception of the previous salary increase for the judge, we have passed, we have supported, we have given the court everything that they've asked for up to this point and all the resources. But this is a point where I am seeing the city potentially on the hook for money that's not approved. And that gives me pause along with the liability. So that's where I stand.
And table this. There was a motion in a second.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's a motion in a second. So unless you, I'm going to ask,
is there a way to just pull the motion? Can somebody make a motion?
I'm just going to call a question. Oh. Yeah.
I'm ready to vote.
I'm going to call for the question. And so, Lori, if you can read the roll call.
Sure. Do you want me to read the motion again?
Yes, please.
Move to approve the city council submit a letter in support for the renewal of the grant application for continued funding of the Bremerton Community Therapeutic Court.
Okay. Perfect. Yeah. Call a question.
Okay. Chamberlain?
Yes.
Fry?
No.
Dennehy?
Yes.
Goodnow?
Yes.
Mockler?
No.
Coughlin?
No.
Got a time.
Mm-hmm.
It's 3 yes and 3 no.
I believe without a majority, the motion does not carry. Okay, thank you. We'll move on to item B2, which is titled Request for Additional Extra Help for On-Call Courtroom Bailiff Position. Judge Flood, you still have, you're up to present this item, so please present.
So this item is being presented as after meeting with finance and unable to engage and have a interlocal agreement with the county, as the county does provide the court with support for the obtaining the jurors and support the director of finance said that the best way to do this would be through a on-call bailiff position. That bailiff has been providing services to us since our last, I believe, 3 or 4 trials.
Are you done with the presentation, Judge Flood?
The agenda bill sets out everything else. I think it's pretty straightforward, and HR language from the agenda bill to establish a job description, as well as I just learned again that the county also sent over their job description that was not forwarded to HR, but it's going to be forwarded to HR.
Okay, thank you. Questions? Yes, Councilmember Chamberlain.
Are we skipping over B1?
I am so sorry. Thank you for that point of order. Okay. Let me take a second. We are on, my apologies. I said, we finished A1. I should have gone to B1 instead. I believe we went to B2.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So let's make that clear. Judge, is that correct? You're presenting on the bail on the request for additional extra help for on-call courtroom bailiff position.
I think that's what I was just.
Okay. Thank you. I just want to double check. Okay. So we are on item B2. Thank you for that clarification, Councilmember Chamberlain. All right. So we are on request for additional extra help for on-call courtroom bailiff position. We're still in study session, so no action taken, but the recommended motion, should this go to general business, is move to approve creation of the on-call bailiff position. All right. Does any council members have any question or comments on this one? Okay, no. So yeah, Councilmember Mockler.
Are these services currently being provided by the county?
No.
So how are these services currently being provided?
The services as far as the bailiff came in because he was told there was going to be an interlocal agreement. So he's been working on good faith that was going to happen, but it didn't happen. So now we're going this route because this is the route that the finance director said we needed to go.
Thank you.
You want to call him?
Director Rose.
So we were short bit connected with the county, with the person that provided extra help previously. Prior to COVID, it was in local agreement with the county and the city to provide these off-call services. We had received an invoice from this person in finance to pay off of, when a contractor could not pay off of that to the individual. We contacted the county. The county at this time was not interested in doing it in LA. So they said they'd be happy to, you know, share service with the individual. So we need to bring this individual on as an extra help paid employee if we want to continue these services, so to be able to pay this individual. So believe that, I don't have the exact case, but I think we're looking back to March, April, sometime like.
Real quick. So this is the same individual who had been hoping for the ILA, and this will give this individual a path forward. Yeah. Thank you. All done.
Thank you.
And this came through the Public Safety Committee. It looks like it's very minimal impact to fiscally, like I think $2,500 a year. Is that right? It was guesstimated. There is an hourly range listed, but I think I've written down here $2,500 a year. So do you happen to know the fiscal, like how much it would cost for, I don't know why I wrote 2,500, but I thought that might be the impact. Do either one of you have an answer for that one?
Sorry.
Okay.
I know I can tell you that in the month of February, between February and March, we were set for 3 trials. He was present for all 3. So as far as trials and, for the Bremerton Municipal Court, we've been holding trials since I took, whereas before they were not holding trials because of COVID.
So it says
that were in place.
It says in the fiscal impacts that really the savings from the vacant positions will help cover this person. So I support it. I'm good with letting this one roll through.
Yeah.
Good enough.
This may be for Director Riley, but do we know what the, so once the next year, hopefully the court will have all the vacancy funds. Do we know what the impact is sort of moving forward?
I can provide that to the council, kind of aggregate where we're at with the initial hire, the changes.
Yeah.
We present just the 2, you know, changes from the last request. We can incorporate this. I do not have the scope of hours for this.
Yeah.
We have a dollar range that we control by the court, but we can get that and put it together.
Yeah, thank you. That'd be great. I mean, I feel like we've heard about this some time ago that this was coming, that the county didn't want to do that anymore. So, and obviously we need to have a bailiff in the court. So just be curious, is that, what the impacts look like on a maybe next year's budget.
Councilmember Demi.
Thanks. Hopefully this isn't redundant, but Judge Flood, basically there isn't a fiscal impact because you're covering the costs within your already budgeted.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Yeah. Thanks. So I support it as well.
I'll wrap up. Same within budget and the rest of the general fund. Sounds good to me. So is consent okay or any requests for general?
Consent.
All right, this will go on consent for next session. Perfect. So that was item B2. Thank you, Councilmember Chamberlain. Appreciate it. So we'll go back to item B1. Which is ordinance to adjust and set the annual compensation for the municipal court judge. And Judge Flood, this is your third item, if you want to go ahead and present.
I think the agenda bill is pretty straightforward. I've been before you on different occasions as to the Washington State Citizens Commission salary that takes place and sets the salary for elected officials. We talked about this at the Public Safety Committee, as well as I believe we talked about it with finance in regards, as well as the city attorney. They have proposed some language and Kali can speak to that.
Fantastic. And before going, I just want to make a request to council in the same vein that when we talked about the mayor's salary compensation, we talked about the chair. The seat's not the person in it, so I want to keep the discussion on the position of judge. All right, and Councilmember Chamber or Councilmember Fry for Public Safety.
Yeah, do you want to speak first?
I think that
we just felt pretty adamant that this needed to come before the council. And I'm still receiving conflicting information though. So yeah, go ahead, Jenna.
I just say we don't accept this grant funding and we carve out $23,500 from the general fund somewhere. If the trial court improvements need to be done, that we find another way to do it rather than accepting, because we only need to accept the salary raise if we accept these funds. So that's where I'm at with this. If we need to just say no to these funds, I'm good with that. I don't see that this is a good way to give this position a raise. I think there's another way that we could do that.
Benny?
And that kind of goes, I'm looking at this from a completely fiscal impact. I believe the municipal court position, the municipal court judge is the highest paid city employee already. Is that correct? Or?
I have to look at that. But
okay. Probably one of them, right? Okay. So I'm looking at it from a dollars and cents standpoint and the taxpayers' funds. So currently, the municipal court judge makes $183,774 annually. That's including deferred compensation. The option A, which seems by my kind of fiscal mind, the most advantageous to the position, getting tax deferred and putting it in the money market, 196,638.60. So that would be increasing $12,864.60. And that was the question I had. How much are the TCI funds that we normally receive? Is it 23,000, as Vice President Chamberlain stated?
Oh, you know, that's the fiscal concept
change.
Can you give me a ballpark of what we recently received?
Last year,
yeah.
Ms. Jennifer said it was a little bit over 23,000.
23,000.
But it does change it.
Okay, so from my standpoint, in order to get the 23,000, we'd be expending 13,000 to get this salary up. From a financial standpoint, it actually makes sense to me to do option A, 91% of the DCJ salary plus 4% compensation. The question I have is the RCW that I've been reading that was included in the packet, this only pertains to state and district court judges. Is that correct?
So the way that it said is it states elected officials. So it gets a little tricky because many city and municipal courts are part-time non-elected positions. So this statute doesn't speak directly to municipalities being in there. That's why the grant program was created, because many municipalities don't want to take a hit of the budget when you're talking about the budget and is it cost effective is when you're talking an analysis there.
But so
the original purpose was to supplement the salary to use those funds. I think the history, as you see, for the last 15 years of being a part of the program, it's in essence allowed for there to be 91% with 4% that qualifies. Sure. As far as the calculation.
So as I read the RCWs, I'm looking at RCW 3.5.080, specifically saying that municipal court judges shall be fixed by ordinance. So it seems that the revised code of Washington already contemplates that municipal entities, i.e. city council, would be determining the municipal court salary. So I think the question I asked in study session of whether or not the RCW was binding or persuasive authority, from my reading of this statute, it actually doesn't really talk to that. It says municipalities. So the only thing that we're really relying on is if we want this TCI grant funding, we need to be at 95%. From a fiscal standpoint, 23,000, if we get that, we're throwing in 13 grand versus if we were gonna throw in 23,000 from the general fund, it saves our taxpayers $7,000 a year. So I'm fine with option A. That's all. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
And, I don't know if this was with shared judges, I was looking at with Jennifer Johnson, preparing the agenda bill, but I'm going to point it out just because I was in my baseball. The Supreme Court actually looked at this varsity delay in 2021. It was a case out of Tacoma Municipal Court. It was actually two municipal court judges were the parties. Lattenberg, the
sorry, did you say Lattenberg?
Lattenberg.
Lattenberg.
A-G-M-K-E. I'm not sure if that's the pronunciation. And so the footnote actually explains, it says Judge Lattenberg claims that Judge Hankey's salary is determined by the state salary commission, and that this is evidence she is a state officer. Pursuant to Article 18, the Washington Citizens Commission on Salaries for Elected Officials set salary for trained field, superior, and district court judges. This provision does not apply, does not mention municipal court judges. Also, and it gives the website for salaries for the judicial branch. WCCSEO does not set the salary of municipal judges. RCW 43-03-012 does not establish the salary of municipal court judges. The salary of Pierce County District Court judges, not Tacoma Municipal Court judges, is set by the WCCSEO.
Look at me, just reasoning and interpreting statutes like the Supreme Court. Okay, that's great. I appreciate that. Okay, so that's super helpful. So basically what that means, folks, is the RCW doesn't have any control. We have control of it. Again, going back to a fiscal impact, I think it makes sense if we want to keep that $22,000 in funding, it saves us $7,000 a year.
And I will say that we've already done the certification for this year.
Okay.
And the I think Ms. Fennell did the code that they did the so I wasn't a part of putting the bill together. I'm just here.
Good.
And then
we're talking about the position.
Right? Yeah. Here in the position.
Everybody's saying that. Yeah.
Any other council members, comments or questions? Good now.
So I just wanted to ask where the July 1 date comes from. Or was is that a request? It's
what was it?
Both the part of the commission's date and then the ALC. And if you look in the packet, it ALC establishes and has the decision making over all the courts and with our court offices. So the July 1 date is a part of the grant funding connected to the Citizens Commission salaries, setting it every July.
Okay.
That's what I think.
Anyone else?
Go ahead, Councilman.
Thank you. I agree with you, Jennifer.
Speak to me. Sorry.
Yeah. Okay. I agree with Councilor Jennifer. Vice President Jennifer. I think that this is not the way to go about getting a salary raise. And I think that I also agree that the municipal court judge position is very, very highly paid. I keep bringing this up, so I'll bring it up quickly. 40% of Bremerton households earn less than $40,000. I think this is a bad example. Yes, we would save $8,000 or $12,000. Nonetheless, I think we should fail to do this. I think we should not give the raise in this way.
I'm gonna close that or we'll do a round and we can do a second round.
Sure.
I got similar stuff. I want to make sure I got this correct because I'm here and I'm not wrong. It's if you're finance. So the current salary is 183,774. Option A, Council Member Denny, he said it'd be 196,638. I'll ask the standing, I'm gonna raise their hand and answer. Do we know what the salary has been in the past, say over 5 years? The reason I ask that is because I appreciate the argument of if the salary increase is not greater than the amount of money we're getting from this grant as a result, then it makes fiscal sense. My worry though is that the salary keeps increasing over time, as it seems that the district court judges' salaries do, since it's tied to it. I'm worried that at some point we need to it doesn't make fiscal sense to keep doing this. That's my worry. So I don't know.
It's been set this way for the last 15 years. And
so yeah,
the grant increases to cover what the cost would be so that the cities aren't footing the bill for the increase. So the program was created so that it could subsidize the pay raise to make it in line and in step with the district and municipal court. So the creation of the grant was for that purpose and reason.
So I think, and I would put any salary increase for a top official, director, or mayor, or judge on general business anyway. So I think I'd like to see a table, I don't know if it's possible to get together, of the salary and compensation over time and the amount of award from that grant over time. I think that would help me make a decision.
That would be helpful.
Mm-hmm. But I will say a lot. I did really appreciate the conversation we had when we talked about raising the salary of the mayor position. And that we I think as a council majority had heartburn over raising it to a very high level given Bremerton's income. So this currently at 183,774 is quite a well compensated position for Bremerton. Yes, Director Riley.
How many years
is that
analysis?
Five. Can you do 10 if possible? Yeah. Just if that's not, yeah, that's too hard, then five. And Attorney Pinnell.
So I was just going to point out, I don't know if you, there was in your packet, the reporting did include the additional salaries for like officials 2023, 2024 schedule. So it goes with current cut salary effective July 1, and salary effective July 1, 2024. So that's on page 18 of the packet. So if you want to see where it's headed, it sounded like you kind of did. There is at least through next year available in the materials that were submitted by the court.
Thank you. I see that now. Okay, yeah, page 18. Got it. Appreciate it. Okay, any other comments or questions? And as I said, I'll at least request this to go in general business.
General business.
But any questions? Yeah, Councilmember Chamberlain, go ahead.
Thank you. Okay, so just clarifying, at one point in time, it was being asked to be retroactively paid. Is that no longer part of this request? Because I think that there was at one point in time you were asking for it to go back in time to be like to retroactively from the last cent will be paid, but is that?
That came up because when HR was contacted and said what was the salary of the judge, the information was provided was the 176,423. So that information was sent to AOC.
So no.
I didn't conclude the deferred compensation at the last time we appeared before you at this when it was time to do the certification for this year to receive.
Okay.
To be a part of the funding, it was stated that the full salary included the deferred comp. So that quashed any issues in regards to what the original presentation was.
Okay. And here's, I just kind of want to give you all a little synopsis of my understanding from the Public Safety Committee meeting, is that what was being communicated to us was that this was now a requirement by the law to increase salaries. And so I just want to that was my interpretation that, the court was saying that it was a requirement and that we were asking for clarification. And so I just appreciate that we do have a case precedent that gives us, you know, the wherewithal to decide on our own if we want to raise the judge's salary in the way that we want. So it is not the law that we need to raise the salary to this level unless we accept this, not the law, it's not the law, it's just a requirement of the grant that if we raise the salary. Okay, I want to make sure that I'm seeing some head nods, so I'm clear on that one. That's it, thank you.
Benny?
I think the last point that I would make is when we were discussing the mayor's salary and even city council salary, which we don't talk about, right? Because, but so the requirement is to be a resident, to be in the district, be over 18, whereas I believe, I'm pretty sure on all these things I'm about to say, you need a doctorate of law that's 3 years, you need to be able to pass the bar. Most likely you need to show competency in trial courts, in evidentiary proceedings. And you also want to incentivize people who are very adept in trial courts so that they know what they're doing, especially around evidence, around everything. So I understand the argument of 40% below 40,000, but I think a city like Bremerton that does have a lot of folks because of that poverty level interfacing with the criminal justice system, we want to attract as much competition, just like the mayor, attract as much competition to incentivize people to run for that role where they might be making more in private sector. So I have less concerns talking about the mayor's salary versus the median versus a professional, like somebody that's required a doctorate in order to do it.
Makes sense. All right, so seeing that, this will go on general business for next meeting.
Mm-hmm.
All right, thank you so much, Judge Flood. I appreciate it. And let's go ahead and take a 10-minute recess.